Well, in case this is coming out before the Spider-Man video I planned on making, this show was unexpected, but then again, sometimes life throws surprises at you. Such surprise is that I happened to binge a recent Netflix show called The Woman in the House Across from the Woman in the Window. What the hell is this title? I have no idea how I even got to this. I just scrolled through Netflix and saw this poster with Kristen Bell on it and thought, hey, I like Kristen Bell. The title is longer than a Lord of the Rings movie, but I guess I can give this a shot. What's gonna happen? And one surprise binge watch later, oh boy, where do I even begin with what happens with this show? Actually, let's start with reconfirming something. I came into this show completely blind. Aside from seeing Kristen Bell stars in it, I knew nothing about its genre, intent, whether or not it's an adaptation of something or its own thing. I knew nothing. I came into this show completely blind to what it's about. I'll explain why it matters later, but let's just say that there's a reason for me to bring this up. Also, spoilers are obviously ahead, so in case you're curious about the show yourself, please close the video and go watch it for yourself. It's not that long, only 8 episodes, with each being around 22 minutes, so I'd say give it a watch and see what you think before you hear me break it down. Still here? Okay, let's do this. The show is about Anna, a somewhat retired artist who is grieving the death of her daughter and divorcing her husband. And if that's not enough, she is also shown to be quite mental. I guess that's the word we'll go with. While the woman is quite clearly depressed and suffers from a severe fear of rain, it's also shown that she's clearly not alright and suffers from hallucinations as well, and those hallucinations are quite graphic. Say what you will about her condition, that woman isn't healthy, and I bring this up because her hallucinations and the mental state she's in are very much plot points in this show. While Anna spends most of her days drinking unhealthy amounts of wine and reading, her plot thickens as new neighbors move in the house across from hers. A single father, who seems to be the perfect new guy for her to fantasize over, and his little girl. The mother of the family has apparently died, and this is a new start for them, which Anna is quite excited about as she stalks them from the window. But all is not well, of course, when the dude has a girlfriend, then that makes Anna jealous because, well, let's face it, you'd be jealous too if your crush dated someone else. Fate strikes, however, as one day Anna witnesses from the window that this girl is dying from a cut in her throat. The police arrives at the scene, but nobody is found, which means there's a mystery afoot, and Anna has to tap into her inside Veronica Mars in order to find out what happened. Be fair, regardless if you watch the show or not, this sounds like a mystery show, isn't it? There's a random murder, no body, supposedly one witness, and that witness is a mentally unhealthy woman who seeks to find the truth. As the show goes along, there are twists, clues, theories, plenty of suspects. Sounds like a pretty good setup for a mystery. Now, I love mysteries. I grew up watching Scooby-Doo, I watched a lot of film noir like Sunset Boulevard, and as the joke from a few seconds ago would imply, I'm a big Veronica Mars fan. I'm always in the market for a good mystery, even if I can figure it out ahead of time. So the idea of a mystery where everyone, including the main character, is a suspect, and we don't really know what's real and what isn't because of Anna's hallucinations, really appealed to me. There's a reason I binged the whole thing, and it's because I enjoy the mystery and all the possible options to what could have happened. Some parts were a little BS, like Anna forgetting her phone just for plot convenience, and there are moments where you wish the characters had a brain in order to avoid situations. Like, seriously, Anna didn't think to alert the police that someone wrote a threatening message on her car window? You're right outside the station, lady! Talk to these people! But regardless, I wanted to figure out what exactly happened and for Anna to not be the killer. I did hope she didn't just imagine the whole thing. That would have sucked, but we'll get to that. Before we talk about the mystery and its resolution, I do want to talk about the characters and their reasons to be the killers, When I say that everyone is a suspect, it's not just me being a suspicious person with trust issues. Every character has their own reason to want that woman dead, and are capable of hurting her. Anna is of course jealous and not right in the mind, so it's very possible she would do something like that, and even the show calls her out for it. Then we have Neil, Anna's new neighbor and partner of the victim. Anna's research into him shows that he was a suspect in his wife's murder mystery, and that he was even in jail until the charges dropped. He is also the main suspect, which the show tries to frame as the guy who did it. We have flashbacks to when he killed his wife and his daughter's teacher. These are actually not flashbacks, that's just how Anna sees the scenarios play up in her mind, but we don't find it out until we discover he is in fact not the killer, and the explanation is fair, I guess. Sloane may have been a supportive character for Anna, but I also suspected that she's the actual murderer because she wanted Anna to get Neil. She just stays the supportive friend for the lead, but I was trying to keep my eyes peeled. Carol hates Anna, so she was easy to suspect, especially when the murder weapon is one of Anna's tools. Who's to torment Anna's life if not the woman who hates her and her problems, legit reasons or not? Rex, sure was a character in this story. He is a suspicious person who was a con partner with the girlfriend, and let's be honest, those are the types of people to actually do it. And yes, the reason I keep calling the girlfriend character the girlfriend is because she has an alias and I wasn't sure which name to use, so that's what you get. Anyway, it seems like Rex did it, but of course he didn't, and he suddenly disappears from the show. Guess the writers needed to have a sex scene where Anna bangs someone, so yeah, there you go, you have Rex. Have at it! And then there's Buell, my main suspect. Even when the show tried convincing me that Neil was the murderer, I suspected Buell the most. Two reasons for this. One, the dude is handy with toolbars and he has literal no sense of pain. There's a point where he has a nail stuck in his hands and he treats it as a scratch. This guy must have killed someone. You can't tell me otherwise. And two, I figured they're playing with the Scooby-Doo logic, where it's always the one you'd suspect the least, and really, who would suspect a guy like Buell? He's pretty not killer-like. The show almost makes Buell the killer, and I was ready with my combat finger, but no. The killer is actually Emma, Neil's daughter. I haven't mentioned Emma much because I figured it will be the best to talk about her in the same breath as the twist, which shows that she was the killer. Up until that point, Emma was just a sweet girl who reminds Anna of her own daughter who sadly died. She's clearly a troubled kid, but her life gave her reason to be troubled, and you can see that she's trying to just carry on. If anything, Anna tries to figure this whole mystery out in order to help Emma have a better life, the life she couldn't give her daughter. But then the twist happens! I want to point out that just like Buell, I was jokingly applying the Scooby-Doo logic to Emma. No one would suspect her, so it had to be her. But I kinda dismissed the thought thinking, nah, no way they'll do that, it's too dumb. Well, congratulations, past HC, you were both right and wrong at the same time. That has to be some sort of an achievement, or a failure of the highest degree. I don't know anymore. Anyway, yeah, Emma did it. The little girl is the killer. I'm not sure if I would call it unexpected, since it did cross my mind. Then again, I dismissed it because I thought it was absolutely ridiculous, so what do I even call that? Well, initially, I saw this whole thing as a bad twist, because while it answers the mystery and explains some things, it misses one important thing. The why. Why would she be the killer? Actually, I take it back, there's a reason why Emma killed her mother, and that's because she was pregnant and Emma didn't want a sibling. A bit extreme, but okay, I guess that's a motivation. and she killed the girlfriend because the girlfriend commented about how sugar isn't good for her. This girl is fucking messed up! In only give or take 5 minutes of her being an actual villain, this little gremlin is 10 times more evil than Frollo, Maleficent, the Joker, and Thanos combined. Don't believe me? Well, let's go over each one, shall we? Frollo is an extremely religious judge who tries to purge the world from evil even though he's doing awful things and uses righteous as an excuse. Maleficent declared war on a kingdom because she wasn't invited to a birthday party. The Joker is just nuts. He has no conscience because it was destroyed by either the society around him or just a bad day, depending on the version. And Thanos wiped out half the freaking universe because he believed that while it was an extreme, he saw it as the right thing to do, and sacrifices sometimes have to be made. Or he's horny, again, depending on the version. Emma is just a little monster with none of these excuses. I get that she's a little kid, and does she jumps to extremes too quickly. But this is pushing it. I could have told someone I'll kill you when I was a kid, but it doesn't mean I'd actually do it. And surely not drown them in the lake or cut them with a knife. What led to this? What made this kid so violent? If this was to happen after she lost the two mother figures, I could have bought it. Only she's the one who killed those mother figures in the first place because she's a fucking psycho! Now, for the record, yes, there are mystery and horror stories where the kids are little monsters. But they had some motivation for it besides just resorting to murder over the smallest of things. Actually, it may not be a horror or mystery movie and the character isn't a kid, but if I may reference another movie in which Kristen Bell played an Anna, Emma has the Hans problem. Both just end up being the villains at the very last possible second without any real build-up towards it. Although I think Emma is worse than Hans in that regard, since Hans does have some hints you could notice on a rewatch, and his turn does work with the team of Frozen. Emma has none of that. I went through the show again just to make sure I absolutely didn't miss a thing, and not even the slightest hint was dropped. There was nothing I missed. It's almost like this twist exists just for the sake of having a twist for the mystery. But even that may not be the case, because now comes the real fucking kicker. Following my surprise binging of the show, I decided to snoop online and see what the deal with it was. Was it an adaptation, an original idea, are there any production notes, production problems? Well, the twist is that this show I just described to you is a parody of the mystery and thriller genres. Even the long-ass title is a parody of the short film The Woman in the House and the novel The Woman in the Window. I didn't have the time to check any of those for myself, but I've heard from people who read The Woman in the Window that it's basically the same thing. We exchange some notes and really there's not much difference. The main character is even named Anna, and she also has agoraphobia, has lost her family, she sits down in front of a window while drinking. I'm surprised they didn't just label it as an adaptation, because from what I've heard, it's basically the same thing. But okay, this show is a parody now. Parodies usually follow pre-established stories and make fun of them. So what's the parody angle? Well, let's just say that finding the parody in this show is a bigger mystery than finding out who killed that woman. I may haven't read the book in question, but I've seen quite a few mysteries in my life, and there's nothing about this show which parodies the mystery formula, nor the thriller ones. But if I have to look for things which are supposed to be funny, I guess the way Anna's daughter died is a joke? I mean, she connects the rain to the day her daughter died, and it happened to rain that day. Forget the fact that losing a kid is never funny, especially when trying to establish a traumatic condition for this character, it goes even further than that. It happened to rain on the day Anna's ex-husband took their daughter to his workplace. His work was taking care of criminals and killers. His boss called them out for a second, so he left the daughter in the same room with a killer who's known to eat people. Is this a parody? Is this funny? Kid being eaten by someone? What? How? Yeah, when I write it down, it's quite a ridiculous chain of events, but I don't take a child dying by cannibalism as a joke. And it doesn't seem like the show is either, as it's filmed all creepily and with harsh lighting in order to give off a sad and melancholy vibes. Should I laugh at this? Are you, whoever is watching this video right now, feeling like laughing after hearing that? Is a child being eaten funny? There's a point where Anna has flashes of herself stabbing the girl who was murdered with one of her tools, which just happens to be the tool which was used to kill that woman. Later we find out that she didn't stab the actual woman, but rather stabbed a drawing she made of her so that she could let out her frustration that this chick is dating Neil. I guess there's a potential for a joke there? But considering Anna is presented to be very mental and hallucinates quite a lot, even possible scenarios in which Neil killed two women, is the joke supposed to be that her mental health is shit? Are we supposed to find a woman being mentally sick funny? Do I even need to explain what's wrong with this? Do I even really need to explain what's so freaking messed up with this idea? Mental health is not funny! Ironically, the one part of the show I could label as a parody is Emma being the killer, because it's so freaking bonkers. But no, this is apparently the same ending as the novel this show is the parody in. So the only part I couldn't take seriously and laugh at because it's so stupid was apparently the one part I'm supposed to take seriously from the actual novel. What in the hell are these writers on? Am I missing something? And it's actually the most amazing parody on the planet? Or is this not actually funny in the slightest and just super fucked up? The ironic thing about all of this is that as a parody, the show just fails. It's not funny, at least not when it tries to be. There are no jabs taken at the thriller mystery formula. The, I'm assuming, attempts at jokes are either horrifying or just nonsensical. They are surely not funny, which is the point of a joke. But if you look at it as a mystery show, strictly a mystery show with no parody whatsoever, it's not that bad. Yeah, the reveal is dumb and there are some stupid moments to be sure, but overall, it's a decent mystery. Like I said, there are plenty of suspects who could have done it, and the show certainly has an atmosphere which makes you question a lot of the things thrown at you. It's not dragging much, and I'd easily say I was invested in most of it. Hell, as a mystery show, it has a better mystery than season 4 of Veronica Mars. I actually figured out who did it there on the very first episode, while this show kept me guessing until the... well, you know already. Anyway, remember when I said at the start of the video that I had no prior info on this show and I came into it completely blind? Well, that's why I felt it was important to bring it up. As someone who just saw it as a random show with an actress I like, I never got the idea that this is supposed to be a parody. Let's start by looking at this poster. Does this look like a poster which would attract the comedy crowd? Kristen Bell's face is looking deadly serious, if not horrified, and her gaze stares at you in a way which is very uncomfortable. The way she puts her hand up as if she's trapped, almost begging for help, the view of the house in dark shadows with only one window lighting up as rain engulfs it, while Anna's character is centered in the middle of the storms to symbolize her homophobia, or however it's called. Does anyone get comedy from this? I asked a few of my friends about this, given them no context, and not one said it's supposed to be a parody or a comedy. I don't know what the Netflix marketing team was thinking when they made this poster and advertised this show as a legit thriller mystery, but you can be sure of one thing. It failed to get that idea across. The tagline is ridiculous and it has to be intentional, but I've seen ridiculous taglines being used completely serious in marketing, so I wouldn't take it as a sign off for a riot of a show. Just a general marketing tool. But I think I talked enough about how much this show isn't what it wants to be and that none of the marketing gets the idea across that it's supposed to be a parody, so guess I'll just leave it at that. But don't think for a second that we're done yet, because we still have to talk about the ending. So, Am I Stopped, Beulah's Alive, Anna is Forgiven, Rex is Forgotten About, The Dead Remain Dead, Salome is Going to New York, Anna and her ex-husband get back together and they remarry, flash forward to Anna taking a flight to visit Salome in New York when Glenn Close sits next to her, random, then Anna sees that Glenn Close was murdered in the bathroom, okay, what a waste of a talent, Anna calls for a flight attendant and they see no one in the bathroom and he tells her that no one is seated in Glenn Close's seat. So we also have a sequel to this. How about no? God, how can I even summarize this show? I mean, it's pretty clear at this point that this show doesn't work from any way you're looking at it. But I can't lie, this show fascinates me. It is a rabbit hole I couldn't stop going down through and just find the layers of confusion which surrounds all of it. It's a parody which isn't making fun of the genre, unless the disturbing stuff I mentioned before are supposed to be the joke. It's a rather competent thriller until the very end, which is downright ridiculous. It has great actors doing their best, but performances can't save a script which downright fails. It follows a book which is supposedly accused of stealing from something else? What even is this show anymore? This is an enigma. This is something I wish for people to study and talk about. What was the intention? What are some of the behind-the-scenes stories for this show? Did Netflix drop the ball? The writers? What happened here? I don't know about whoever watches this video, but I'll speak for myself when I say that this show fascinated me. It got me thinking, wondering, researching, asking around, talking to a bunch of friends who may have gotten sick of me mentioning this show. I can't drop it. I'm pretty sure I can even call it my new addiction, because it's so freaking bonkers, weird, insane, I don't know how to describe it anymore. If there's one actual mystery I want to solve in my life, is finding out what the production was like for this show. What was the thought process? What was supposed to be funny? What were the actors told while filming? What were the marketers trying to push? What do people who read the book think about this? Apparently the original book was accused of copying the plot of another book, so what the hell is the deal with that? Was this supposed to be an adaptation of the book? The Women in the Window, or the one which is copied from? There are so many questions which honestly fascinate me about this show. What the hell happened with the woman in the house across from the street from the woman in the window? And why is this title so damn long?